Now, for the great debate of the evening. Poles apart we may be, but I rate Peter Hitchens very highly as a polemicist and as a debater. And I'm about to debate with him on the subject of prisons. I set out my views clearly earlier on, so let's hear from Peter in person. Peter, thanks for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
Now, we're dealing with this subject really in the wake of John Centenu, the bishop who rather, I thought, in an unchristian way, laid into the lives of prisoners in a speech that he made in the week, which seemed to echo some of the things, at least, not all by any means, that you had previously written and which I had enjoyed in your book and in the Mail on Sunday, enjoyed in the sense that they were at least serious ideas being seriously expressed. Why don't you, just to get us, kick us off, go through what you think is wrong with the British prison system?
Well, the main thing that's wrong with it is that it has no proper purpose. We still have prisons, many of them built in the Victorian era when there was a general belief in the punishment of people who'd committed wicked deeds, both to reform them and to deter other people from committing such wicked deeds, which were also, of course, crimes, otherwise they couldn't have been imprisoned. What we have instead really is a system of warehouses where a baffled state, which doesn't believe in punishment for its own sake, has no real conception of right or wrong, warehouses prisoners for fairly brief periods in between long patches of criminal careers. And in those places, partly because there is no sense that the state believes that there is a difference between right and wrong, the prisoners themselves are treated in a very peculiar way. That is to say, they're allowed to have various privileges, such as televisions in their cells, telephones to the outside world, pool tables, and illicitly, but in fact with the authorities nodding at it, a fair number of illegal drugs as well. Many of these things are allowed because one of the things the authorities fear most of all is that there will be prison riots, and they would prefer that the prisoners were kept occupied, preoccupied, entertained, or even zonked than that they did that. But there's absolutely no conception, the way these places are run, of any really proper purpose. In fact, you get the sense that the state is rather embarrassed that it's inherited the idea of prison from the past, holds onto it partly to appease the public, which it knows is much more hostile to crime than the elite is, and partly because it can't think of anything else to do. And the ultimate argument that supposed hardliners, though they're really liberals, such as Michael Howard, can come up with is that prison works to the extent that while somebody is in prison, he can't be outside prison committing crimes, which seems to me to be a pretty feeble and futile approach to the problem of dealing with crime. Of course, the idea that prison by itself can control or prevent or deter all crime and all misdeeds is ridiculous. A society which wants to have ordered liberty has to have a population which understands the difference between right and wrong and knows how to behave. And one of the things that's broken down in the same period that the idea of punishment has disappeared is that idea that there is such a thing as right and there is such a thing as wrong, and people should be obliged to restrain themselves from doing things which they know to be bad.
Well, much of that I agree with, in fact. But it doesn't solve the problem or answer the conundrum that we have this gigantic prison population. You yourself have charted the extraordinary rise from the 1960s until now. I think in 1931, in figures in one of your pieces I saw, the prison population was only just into double figures.
No, well, in thousands, you mean?
Yes.
It has gone up enormously.
It's now chasing 100,000.
Yes, and unless something very radical is done, it will continue relentlessly to grow. Two things might happen. One is that the government will simply stop imprisoning people, which is trying to do anyway, and the whole system of electronic tags and early release and fictional prison sentences, it keeps the prison population from probably being much nearer 150,000, or it's going to learn that if you wish to control crime, then the whole social policy which it's been pursuing for the past 50 or 60 years is wrong and must be changed. And one of the elements of that would seem to me to be the reintroduction of the old principle of the prison commissioners, who ran what must have been among the most civilized prisons in the history of mankind between about 1890 and about 1960, which was the due punishment of responsible persons. That is to say, you said that if someone was a responsible free individual and behaved himself, the state had no interest in him. But if he decided to break the law and was caught and convicted in a proper court and came up for sentence, then he would be sent to a prison where he would suffer severe deprivation, not merely of liberty, but of the normal privileges of life. And it, to such an extent that people would be scared of going there. And those who'd been there would find the experience so unpleasant. I don't mean torture or brutality, which I strongly disapprove of, but simply unpleasant because it's austerity and it's hard work, that they wouldn't want to go back once they'd come out. And that's how it used to work. Once you abandon that, but you still retain prisons, you will find that an awful lot of criminals regard prison even as a rest. The idea that prison is a holiday camp is ridiculous. Anybody who's been inside a prison...
Well, you and I have both visited prisons.
They
are fetid and foul places.
They're horrible places, and the better sort of person you are, the more hateful you'd find it to be in one. And that's the problem, that for a really bad person, a person who's prepared to be an intimidating, violent cheat, then prison isn't that bad an experience. He can cope. It's the weak and the pathetic who suffer most. And of course, one of the dreadful things about prison is the huge number of suicides that take place.
Indeed.
Inside prison.
Let me explore that area first with you, Peter. All studies show that a huge number of the prison population, a huge percentage of the prison population, are people with drink and drug or both habits. Another substantial proportion, you yourself have conceded this in your writing, are people who should properly be under the care of medical professionals.
Well, I haven't conceded it. I've stated it. It's not a thing that needs to be conceded or that doesn't fit in with my position, which I've frequently stated that one of the great disasters of post-war social policy was the care in the community approach to mental illness and the destruction of mental hospitals, which left an awful lot of people with nowhere to go who have ended up in prison. If you visit any prison, you will find one corridor given over to people who are plainly insane and completely beyond any kind of reason, or and are just being held in prison when they ought to be in a secure or even an ordinary mental hospital. And that this is a disgrace, and it's one of the many, many bad things about the care and the community policy.
That's not
a concession by me. When you talk about drugs and alcohol, my view is that people who are habitual drunks and people who are habitual drug users are not victims, but the people who've inflicted these things upon themselves by their own deliberate decision. So I don't say that they're in prison because they've got some disease and they require sympathy. They're in prison partly because they have abandoned themselves to stupid actions which have helped to bring them there. I believe people who take drugs and get drunk are responsible for the actions which they do when they're drunk or drugged, because they had a choice as to whether they took the drugs or drank the drink.
Well, plainly, but being an addict to alcohol or narcotics is an illness.
No, it's not. I mean, I don't...
It doesn't start out as an illness, but it must become one.
It's one of the many ways in which modern society tries to evade the basic individual responsibility which we all have to behave well. There's the genetic explanation, there's this word addiction. What does it mean?
Well, it
means that a person is incapable of controlling himself. You and I no doubt like a lot of things which we know will either harm ourselves or harm others if we do them, and we try therefore to control ourselves, even though we would like to do them more. We say we won't do that. Everybody's free to do that, and I'm sorry, I don't believe in addiction. I think it's a ridiculous concept, and it's time society re-examined this excuse-making for human weakness. People can not do these things, and anyone who's had anything to do with, say, with Alcoholics Anonymous will tell you that nobody will ever stop being an alcoholic, so-called. What the technical difference is between an alcoholic and a habitual drunk, I don't know. Nobody will ever stop being one of those things unless they want to stop.